Hi, good evening, everybody. At the very outset, I must thank team Apollo Artho, Dr. Siddharth Yadav and Dr. Agnesh Tikku in particular. It is really a wonderful initiative, I must say, and though it has happened in Corona, but I must say that this is a wonderful concept. This can continue even post-Corona as well. So my topic is clinical examination of the elbow today. So first of all, what are the prerequisites before you actually start examining a patient of what are the prerequisites of examination? I mean, you have to have introduce yourself. It is just not that straight away you start taking history or anything. You must greet the patient, come good afternoon, good morning, whatever the point of time, build a slight rapport with the patient, make the patient comfortably seated or lying in the bed. And you should have a consent of the patient before touching. Actually, you just not touching left and right. Explain to the patient that before touching, avoid touching with a cold hand. Your nails should be trimmed. You should have a professional look, and you should have all the gadgets which are going to be required in examination, like goniometer, tape, hammer, pen, paper, pencil, and marker, etc. So what are going to be learning outcome for this lecture today? After that, hopefully you should be able to take a good history. You should have an approach of systematic examination, and most probably you will be able to reach a differential diagnosis and how to reach to a likely diagnosis and how to confirm the diagnosis. This is what the learning outcome is going to be. You should also know, and hopefully you should be able to understand how to demonstrate and elicit various aspect of examination, particularly special tests, and what should be the treatment approach and decision making. When we talk of history, obviously examination of elbow is not before history. You have to have a quick history and brief intro, name of the patient, address the patient by name, age, gender, occupation, and dominance of hand is particularly important in upper limb. So you must not ignore that. What are the common chief complaints? Generally, the chief complaints are pain, swelling, stiffness, deformity, instability of elbow, or at times can be neurological symptoms like paresthesia, numbness and tingling, or pins and needles, or weakness in the limb, especially when there is ulnar nerve involvement. Or maybe patient may complain that I'm not able to use this hand for proper function. So when you obviously you follow the same system, whether you follow in orthopedics or in any other part of the medicine, you have to follow the same system. That is history of chief complaint, history of present illness. And you start with the present illness. The most common is obviously the pain. And you have to see the, what is the onset, what is the duration and progression. Best is to remember the mnemonic OPD. You start with OPD, then exact location of the pain. What are the aggravating and relieving factor? Is there any diurnal variation, particularly if there is a night pain? That means the things are not really good. Is one more important also, what is the effect of this pain on the things like sleep? If it is affecting sleep, that means it is a significant pain. That means you have to investigate aggressively and you have to reach to the diagnosis. Is it affecting the daily activities? If the patient is able to carry out with the symptom daily activities, you may not necessarily need any intervention. And you also need to know whether pain and particular action or the range of motion or what is the need of painkiller. If the patient is routinely needing painkiller, that means the patient needs some sort of intervention to get rid of his problem. If there's an injury, exact mechanism of injury, fall from which height, how much height, was it twisting injury, was it injury on the outstretched hand or directly on the elbow. So that is important. And also what injury, when, what happened exactly, when, where, and how it happened, was it any work-related, and what was the subsequent treatment or event, history of any massage and desi treatment, particularly in India, it's very common and we need to know that because consequences are entirely different. And what is the delay in the injury and reporting actually. Whether there is any referred pain is coming from cervical spine or shoulder pain, at times can be it is because pain in the elbow, not necessarily always because of the pathology in the elbow, it can be because of the referred pain as well. Whether there is any other joint involvement, polyarthralgia can be part of the systemic problem, not necessarily a local problem. So any history of associated constitutional symptom, you must ask whether the symptom changes better, it becomes better or worse with any movement of the neck or shoulder, that will pinpoint indirectly to the referred pain, or does elbow ever slip out or feel unstable, that is suggestive of instability of elbow. So you have to complete the box. You have to tick all the boxes, other relevant history like past medical and past surgical history, any surgical intervention in the past to the any previous injury, any previous treatment taken, any medication patient is presently on. Particularly, never forget the history of drug allergy. Obviously, you have to ask the person, family history, socioeconomic history, just to complete the box, but they are, everything is important, especially if patient is alcoholic, smoker, those things are equally relevant. And then you jump on to the next part, which is essentially the examination of elbow, which is the topic today. You again need to have a very systematic approach. And if you don't follow a systematic approach, you'll start jumping from one to other. And there, in the end, you'll be completely confused and you're not going to be reaching anywhere. So you have to have a systematic approach. It should be look, feel, move mainly. Inspection, palpation, and range of motion to start with. Then, of course, the measurement everywhere in orthopedics and also in case of elbow. Then there are special tests, and especially special tests like stability of elbow or ulnar nerve examination, any distal neurovascular deficit, lymph node examination, and examination of adjacent joint. One should not forget. And of course, one has to compare with the normal limb. Always start with the normal limb. What are prerequisites of examination? You must have a complete exposure of both upper limb. Always start with the normal side first. Never hurt the patient. Be gentle. Take permission and explain the procedure before touching. Be very sensitive and sympathetic. Of course, you must ensure and respect the patient privacy. You have to have the curtains around. It has to be into that area, not open in the ward. The approach of the clinical examination in trauma case is different from the non-trauma condition. It also differs from acute injury compared to chronic injuries. When you talk of inspection or the look, it has to be again, just for the sake of ease, there are structure like skin, after that there is soft tissue, and after that there is a bone and joint. And if you follow that sequence, you're not going to forget anything, you're not going to miss anything. And then you also examine the patient from front, from the side, and from the back. And in inspection, when you're talking of skin examination, then you look for any scar, sinus, edema, or engorged vein. And then next would be your soft tissue, whether there is any muscle wasting or any swelling. Either there can be wasting or swelling. And the swelling can be around para or olecranon area, and or in can be enconius, soft tissue, soft spot. It can be in radiocapitular joint area, or it can be generalized swelling, diffuse swelling, and elbows generally tend to be in semi-flex position. And then you talk of last with your bones and the joint. What is attitude and deformity? Is there any fixed flexion deformity? Is there any flexion deformity? You cannot say fixed flexion at this stage because you're still inspecting. Or is there any obvious deformity, and what is happening to the carrying angle? And that's what, is there any limb length discrepancy? That all apparent limb length discrepancy and everything is going to be coming there. When you talk of further from the front, position of joint, whether it is extended or flexed, it is supinated or pronated, what's happening to the carrying angle from behind, the position of olecranon, unduly prominent, obviously you are going to suspect dislocation. From the side, whether there is any AP broadening of the elbow or is there or not. Swelling can be diffuse swelling, like in over the olecranon process, like swelling can be just over the olecranon process, like student's elbow or olecranon bursitis. It can be in the front, like in anticubital fossa. Most common condition is myositis, ossificans. You can see a picture on the right side with X-ray. And also it can be on the lateral side, like dislocated elbow again, seeing here. It can be muscle wasting all around, or any surgical scar or sinuses you have to see. Any deformity, flexion deformity is common following elbow injury or any arthritis, cubitus valgus, we all know that it is excessive carrying angle, or cubitus varus, that means the angle has decreased, rather it has become more on the varus side. Again, an example of right elbow decreased carrying angle called as cubitus varus generally tend to develop after supraclavicular fracture, humerus malunited. Inspection again, if you see this a fresh injury in a child, anterior bruising and all deformed, most likely a supraclavicular fracture. There is another on the right side, there is a swelling, there is a scar mark, there is a wasting, everything you must notice and must see that. And then, for example, if you see on this slide, there's a diffuse swelling along with the wasting of arm muscle as well as the forearm. That means it's a chronic condition, and most likely condition is tuberculosis of elbow. There's a flexion deformity along with the muscle wasting. Then from the lateral, you must examine and inspect the lateral recess, medial epicondyle, anticubital fossa, olecranon tip, prominence of olive printing tip, already I told you, may indicate posterior, posterior lateral dislocation or tricep avulsion injury. Any ecchymosis anteriorly may indicate bicep tendon rupture or maybe subsubclavian fracture, highly grossly displaced type 3. Ecchymosis medially may indicate a fracture of the medial epicondyle. So you have to inspect from the anterior, lateral, medial, and posterior aspect. Posterior lateral swelling implies generally the fluid or arthritis in the joint. It can be septic arthritis or other arthritis. Second will be feel or palpation. So palpation, again, you start with the 2T, as always, local rise of temperature. Always start first with the normal side, then compare it to the opposite side, then feel for tenderness, and then bony component, then soft tissue component, ulnar nerve thickness, and supratrochlear lymph node. You have to tick all these boxes to complete your palpation part. When you talk of local rise of temperature, that common condition can be infective, pyogenic, completely warm, tuberculosis, little bit rise of temperature, not necessarily that warm, and any inflammatory arthritis like polyarthritis, acute myositis can have local rise of temperature, or any tumor condition around the elbow can have some local rise of temperature. Even an acute traumatic injury like hematoma or edema at 10-10, there can be local rise of temperature, but of course it's not only as high as in case of pyogenic arthritis. Then tenderness, it can be superficial tenderness or it can be deep tenderness. Superficial, generally it's cellulitis, deep myositis or any arthritis. It can be localized tenderness or a diffuse tenderness. You have to differentiate. And then also palpate for thickness, thickening of synovium. There will be doughy feeling of synovium, and typically in rheumatoid arthritis form. Any abnormal mobility you must assess, and positive cross flexion test. That means cross fluctuation test. That means the fluid in the joint. And also, as I've told you, the bony, you have to palpate for the bony tenderness, bony irregularity, any soft tissue swelling or the bony swelling, and then you must describe the swelling individually or separately. Any abnormal mobility or crepitus in the elbow, you have to have a systematic approach, lower humerus, head of radius, upper part of the ulna, olecranon process, three bony point prominence like olecranon tip, medial and lateral epicondyle. Olecranon fossa you must examine, palpate, and you have to palpate ulnar collateral ligament, soft tissues in upper arm, forearm, wrist for pain or provocation, pain provocation or any heat or swelling. Again, just reiterating, bony component, palpate for irregularity, any bowing or thickening or any step, and also palpate for the medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle, olecranon, supraconyl ridges, particularly if there can be some abnormality, irregularity in case of malunited supraconyl fracture or recently healing. Palpate for radial head, capitulum, and soft tissue, medial aspect, lateral aspect, posterior aspect, and anterior aspect. You need to have a systematic approach. You need to go all around so that you don't miss anything. On the lateral aspect, you need to know how to palpate the radial head, and also need to palpate lateral epicondyle, radial head, lateral olecranon, fossa, and soft spot on the lateral side. Palpation from the medial side, again, very important. Have to have a systematic approach, like medial epicondyle, anticubital fossa mobile, wart pad, and bicep tendon, brachial pulse. On the medial side, flexor, pronator, mass, ulnar nerve. Then it's also important, and you may be asked this question, how to feel for the radial head. So you must do is flex the elbow in 90 degree, feel for the lateral condyle, and then there is a, just slide your thumb distally, there will be a dip. And after that in dip, there is again a prominent or some solid structure is going to be palpated. And then you rotate the forearm, supinate and pronate. And if it is rotating, that means it confirms the diagnosis that it is a radial head. Tenderness, maximal tenderness. Tenderness, if it is a typical tenderness and localized, this can pinpoint to the particular diagnosis as well. For example, tenderness, lateral epicondyle, it is invariably tennis elbow, medial epicondyle, golfer elbow, lower end of the humerus, supraconyl fracture, humerus, radial head fracture, upper end of ulna, of course, in acute injury, it can be olecranon fracture. Then you also need to know Anconius triangle, what are the key points, the epicondyle, laterally, the olecranon, and the radial head actually. Then next step, you're going to the step three after examination, which essentially means you're going to jump on to the move, which is range of motion. The range of motion, you start always with the active, start with the normal limb first, and then followed by the passive. normal range of motion you all know is mainly is the flexion extension. You all need to know what are the normal range of motion possible. This is flexion and extension and supination and pronation. So what are the normal range? It is 0 to 140 degree plus minus 10 degrees. In 80 to 90 degrees, the forearm rotation, that is supination or pronation. And with progressive flexion, you also need to know that elbow tend to move into the valgus position. Also need to know how to measure exactly in the degrees actually. What you need to do is you need to, on the lateral aspect, put this goniometer center on the joint level just distal to the lateral epicondyle, and then keep one limb of the goniometer fixed, which is the proximal limb, and start moving the limb, the forearm. Along with that, you move this the distal wing of the goniometer as well, and that's going to yield you a particular degree, and that you can document actually. So there, at times, because of generalized laxity of the ligament associated with increased range of motion, distinctly uncommon in throwing athlete. You also need to know what is the functional range of motion. It is essentially 30 degree of flexion extension and 50 degrees of rotation in each direction. Reason for that is if there is a limitation of movement to this extent only and no pain, the patient can easily get away with that, and you may need not to do any intervention. This is an example of flexion and extension, 135, 0 to 135, 90, 90 degree in supination and pronation, both sides. Again, example of flexion and extension, you have to demonstrate like that. Then also need to know, as already told, what is the critical angle of the flexion is 30 to 110 degrees. If patient can get away with this without any pain, not necessarily in despite of any morbidity or problem, you may not need to have intervention. So it is important you need to know that. Again, supination and pronation, elbow, you have noticed that elbows are tucked on the side, so that shoulder movement is not going to be, otherwise you are going to be deceived by the shoulder movements. So you have to negate the shoulder movement by tucking, or ask the patient to keep the forearms, elbow on the table actually, and hold a pen, and this in neutral position, supination and pronation, and you can note the degree of this. Again, an example of both supination and pronation, functional range is 50 degree in either. You also need to know what are the various joints which are causing these movement. The radiocapital joint, superior and inferior radioulnar joints are the mainly the joint which causes the range of motion, supination and pronation. And what are the reasons for there's a loss of function of the range of motion? Actually, you also need that. It can be questioned. It can be capsular contracture, it can be capsular strain, it can be muscular tendons contracture or strain. It can be because of loose body, osteophyte formation can cause block or scar tissue. You, along with the range of motion, you also need to document whether it's painful or painless. If it is painful, it is throughout the arc of the range of motion, or it is terminally, or is there any associated crepitus? And what is the end feel like? Is it end feel is bony, which means that some bony block is there, or it is a soft tissue? If it is soft tissue feeling, the firm feeling, that means it is not the bony pathology which is causing, it's mainly because of the contracture of soft tissue. 50% of the throwing athletes may have some degree of elbow contracture, also need to know. And also in this case, in particular in the figure on this side, there is a hyperextension. At times there is 0 to 10 degrees of hyperextension is always there. So then you start with a range of motion minus 10 to 130 or 140 degree, which means minus 10 through 0 to 140 degree. So minus 10 itself means there is a hyperextension. So next question you may be asked in exam, what are the flexors of the muscles of the elbow? And what is the nerve supply? The flexors of the elbows is bicep, brachialis, and nerve supply is musculocutaneous nerve. Extensor, triceps, and nerve supply is radial nerve. Supination caused by supinator and bicep and nerve supply is two musculocutaneous nerve and deep branch of radial nerve. Pronation caused by pronator teres, pronator quadratus, and the nerve supply is median nerve. Then the next question is measurement. So you also need what you are going to measure. You are going to measure 3-point bony relationship. You are going to draw a triangle. And what is there in happening compared to the opposite side? What is arm length and arm girth? Whereas if there is in the wasting, you have to measure obviously the girth as well. Forearm length and the girth, carrying angle, that cannot be assessed if there is a fixed flexion deformity. The next is carrying angle, which is most important. You will commonly ask, you need to know what is the normal carrying angle. Normal carrying angle, female has got more like 10 to 15 degree compared to male 7 to 10 degrees, and it disappear on the pronation or flexion of the elbow. So you cannot be comparing or measuring when the elbow is in prone position, and you must compare, and of course start with the normal position first. carrying angle, example, male, female, you have to draw a line, and this is the center joint, and then with the goniometer, of course, you're going to, and if it is less carrying angle, it's a cubitus varus. If it's more, it is cubitus valgus. And most common to condition, non-united lateral condyle fracture or malunited can lead to cubitus valgus, whereas malunited supracondylar fracture can lead to cubitus varus. Again, this is where how you draw and also measure, for example, 13 degree here it is coming. These are the very important, you cannot get away with elbow examination if you don't know how to draw this. You have to mark the medial epicondyle, the lateral epicondyle, the tip of holocronon, and mind you, in the straight extension, it will become straight line. In 90 degree only, it is becoming a triangle, and this is isosceles triangle, not a very equal triangle. Okay, then it is, you also need to know what are the condition where it is disturbed and where it is maintained. It is maintained in supracondylar fracture, it is reversed, the apex will become posterior in case of posterior distribution of elbow, because the olecranon tip is going to different, and the base of triangle is going to broaden in case of intercondylar fracture, and also going to be disturbed in case of lateral intercondylar fracture. And then so the further measurements are like segment, upper limb, how to measure the upper limb length. You need to know, you mark in the angle of acromion, that is, you must draw the angle of acromion, which is just the posterior margin and the lateral margin of the acromion. You must put a mark, then also put a mark on the radial stellate process, which is easily palpable, just proximal to the anatomical snuff box. And then you mark and that the whole into the anatomical position, you compare on the normal and then abnormal. Then you just arm, which is mean essentially upper arm, the angle of acromion to the lateral epicondyle. And if you talk of forearm, which is lateral epicondyle to radial stellate, and then you also need to know what are the radial column, how to measure, and how to measure ulnar column. If you start measuring radial column, essentially lateral epicondyle to the radial stellate process, and medial column is medial epicondyle to ulnar stellate process. You also need to know how to measure girth of elbow to assess whether it is investing objectively or not. You have to mark on the both side a fixed point where most was some muscular area on the both side, equal point from distance from either shoulder or elbow, and then measure on the girth on the both side and compare it to the opposite side. Then the next is special test. You must examine for stability of elbow, ulnar nerve, test for tennis elbow, test for the golfer elbow, and bicipital tendinitis. You need to know this, that what you are going to looking at, so that you can stepwise do that. When you talk of stability, there is no inherent stability to elbow almost, but having said, still in full extension there is some stability by olecranon fossa and olecranon process articulating, and also some provided by the radial head. And if there's a fracture, there's going to be instability. So it is difficult to examine due to free range of shoulder. So you have to put the patient in either in supine or in prone position, but shoulder should be externally rotated. And the elbow should be in 45 degrees of flexion to avoid that inherent stability, so that you can assess exactly the ligament, the varus and valgus actually, and then you apply the stress. Furthermore, you are testing for ulnar collateral ligament. You have to stabilize the proximal arm up, and then you apply a valgus stress. And similarly, you can do it in prone position as well. And that is another example of putting into the valgus stress. This is example of putting testing for the radial collateral ligament. Elbow is the arm is stabilized and forearm is being stressed into the varus side, medial side, which is essentially testing for the lateral collateral ligament. Again, an example of valgus stress test, varus stress test. Then there is another, if there is a valgus varus stress positive in particular, then only you go for this test, which is posterior lateral rotatory instability test, essentially also called a pivot shift test, or O'Driscoll's signs. Only perform the technique, the patient is supine, arm is overhead, supination, and valgus with axial compression of elbow is now flexed at 40 to 70 degree, and the radial head is maximally subluxated. Additional flexion caused a visible clunk of the reduction. This can also be performed by holding a chair. Ask the patient to hold the chair and turning to back toward the chair. And if a patient is reluctant to fully extend the elbow, that means posterior lateral instability can be there. The next is ulna, which is important structure around the elbow. You must palpate in the behind the medial epicondyle into the groove, whether there is any thickening on that. And thickening, we know that it can be conditioned called as Hansen disease or leprosy can cause thickening of elbow. Also test for subluxation. Gently palpate the nerve between the medial epicondyle and olecranon. Now ask the patient to flex and extend. And on flexion, there will be subluxation of the nerve anteriorly with palpable snap. 15% of population with normal population can have ulnar nerve which can subluxate. The next will be ulnar nerve stress test. Ask the patient to flex the elbow, forearm in supination, wrist in dorsiflexion, and this can cause provocation. This is a provocation test for ulnar nerve test. Entrapment, then it will cause some pins and needles or some numbness in wrist, the hand and the arm. This is a provocation test, again the example. Then next will be tunnel test. Gentle percussion of the ulnar nerve above or within the cubital tunnel should not elicit pain in the normal elbow. However, it can cause paresthesia or pain in case of positive test. Also need to know what are the distribution of sensory distribution. And we all know that one and half finger is being supplied by purely and particularly the autonomous zone is the tip of the little finger. And you have to test for the sensory level here. The next test is for tennis elbow, the Mills maneuver and Cousin test. Bicipital tendonitis can be tested by Jurgensen sign. So this is Mills maneuver. Ask the patient to keep the elbow at flexed at 90 degree, forearm slightly pronated and wrist in dorsiflexion. And patient is tries to supinate the forearm against the resistance that is going to typically produce pain on the lateral aspect of the elbow. That essentially is a test for tennis elbow. Okay, here again the example, Mills test, the Cousin test, ask the patient to forcefully dorsiflex the wrist against the resistance. And there's another test called Moses test, which is dorsiflexion of the middle finger, and that is going to cause pain at the elbow. Again, this is an example of the Cousin test, wrist and dorsiflexion, resisted dorsiflexion is causing producing pain. Chair test is another test, patient will be reluctant to hold the chair. And this is test for the golfer's elbow. You do the reverse of the maneuver. And for bicipital tendonitis, supination of the forearm against the resistance with elbow at 90 degree produce the pain at the bicep tendon. And you must conclude the examination, however, in everywhere in orthopedics and in elbow also by examination on the motor, sensory, and thickening of ulnar nerve, which already I've told you, but distal neurovascular deficit, essentially, that's what I'm going to, I'm highlighting. So a distal neurovascular can be tendon reflexes, can be motor, can be sensory, and pulses are brachial and radial pulse, of course, ulnar pulse, the capillary refill, and if there is a doubt, the go for oxygen saturation. And you have to examine the adjacent joint, particularly the cervical spine, the shoulders, the wrist. Of course, don't forget, you have to always compare it with opposite elbow. When you talk of distal neurovascular deficit, neurologically, the bicep reflex C5, C6, triceps C6, C7, supinator jerk C5, C6, ulnar nerve, median nerve, and radial nerve has to be examined briefly, and the radial ulnar pulse has to be seen. Pulse also, you need to know that, you need to see that pulse should be checked in both arms, and the quality of pulse should be well documented, and what is the rate compared to opposite side. Any dampened pulse may indicate proximal obstruction. Capillary refill and general perfusion should be checked if in any particular complaining of ultrasensation of the finger. This is just a brief graph, just a median nerve, just a position of the fingers, the crossing over of the fingers, and abduction and adduction of the fingers, ulnar nerve, thumb up, this is essentially you're talking of radial nerve, wrist up is talking of radial nerve. And then you also need to know what are the various sensory area. Ulnar, green zone is ulnar, this pink is radial, the rest is of course is median nerve. The autonomous zone for the ulnar nerve is tip of the little finger, tip of the median index finger is median nerve, and the dorsal aspect of the first web space is autonomous zone of sensory supply of radial nerve. And if there's any injury, obviously median nerve dysfunction is going to loss of sensation, especially on the this area, thenar and 3.5 fingers actually. And of course, don't forget to examine the lymph node, the maxillary lymph node, and epitrocheal node. And then you can be asked examination question, how to palpate for supratrachyal lymph node. You must flex the elbow at 90 degrees and so that surrounding structures are relaxed. Palpate on the anterior surface on the medial side and feel for intermuscular septum 1 centimeter above the medial epicondyle. Not palpable in normal patient, but can be palpable either unilateral or bilateral. Adjacent and C-spine, quickly range of motion, any tenderness, shoulder, quick range of motion, any tenderness or restriction. And then you must reach to the diagnosis. You have to make anatomically which part is affected and what is the pathology. So you have to have a two-component to diagnosis. So whether it is a pathological, it is synovitis, arthritis, dislocation, synostosis, myositis, ossificans, malunion, or non-union. These are the common diagnoses you're going to have. So what next? The examiner is going to ask you what to do next. So you have to be careful. Don't jump on to, even if you know the diagnosis, don't jump on, I'll do surgery. You need to take a pause, step back, hold yourself. Next is always confirm the diagnosis by investigation. And in orthopedic, the first investigation is X-ray. And you have to say that X-ray of elbow, AP, and lateral X-rays invariably, and if required, further, like if you are suspecting inflammatory pathology, you're going to ask for CBC, ESR, CRP. You can ask for specialized investigation as well, like CT, MRI, ultrasound, stress X-rays, arthrogram, EMG, and nerve condition studies. Not necessary in all the cases, but you have to be specific, and if required, particular investigation, then you're going to be asking for. You also need to summarize. When examiners are going to say that what is diagnosis, you are not going to jump on this as lateral condyle fracture non-union or just a malunited supracondylar fracture. Your diagnosis should be, as a postgraduate, it is a 10-year-old gentleman by the name, male or female, is a student, occupation is touching, right or left dominance of the hand you have to mention, malunited supracondylar fracture with the range of motion full or not full, you have to say that. Is it painful or painless? You have to say that. With cubitus varus, for example, if there's a deformity of 15 degree without any neurovascular deficit, without any comorbidities, and patient is able to carry out all or not able to carry out daily activities. So that is going to have a complete picture so that the decision can be made on your diagnosis. You just saying that supracondylar malunited fracture does not mean anything because that's not going to yield any approach to the treatment. Your diagnosis should be leading to the treatment as well. So if I ask permission to from Dr. Agnivesh, shall I continue briefly or shall I stop here?
Sir, I think we can continue and try to wind up in the next 5 minutes because we have questions also. Yeah.
Quickly, common exam cases are going to be cubitus varus, cubitus valgus, cubitus varus mainly because of malunited supracondylar fracture. Cubitus valgus mainly because of non-union of lateral condyle, and it can be associated with tardy ulnar palsy, and tardy ulnar palsy, that means it's slowly onset, gradual onset palsy, and it happens because of the gradual stretching. It can be neglected posterior dislocation of elbow. It can be ankylosis or stiff elbow, that can be because of trauma, because of infection, because of myositis ossificans. Again, just to common list conditions are tennis elbow, cubitus varus, valgus, cubitus valgus, tardy ulnar palsy, ulnar neuritis, ulnar tunnel syndrome, olecranon bursitis, pulled elbow, osteoarthritis of elbow, or osteochondritis dissecans. Rheumatoid, it can be rheumatoid arthritis, it can be tuberculosis of elbow, it can be myositis ossificans, it can be a fracture, dislocation, non-union, malunion, those kind of things. So these are all conditions of elbow you need to be aware of. So tennis elbow, there will be classical tenderness at the lateral epicondyle at the region of the common extensor origin. Pulled elbow generally happens at 2 to 5 years age group, history of lifting the child with extended elbow by the forearm pulling. So continuous screaming of child will not allow the person to be the elbow to be examined, and it happens due to the subluxation of the radial head out of annular ligament. Annular ligament, there won't be any obvious swelling or deformity. X-ray will be essentially normal, and the treatment is of course the reduction, and there will be instantaneous relief. When you talk of cubitus varus, you're talking of gunstock deformity, medial deviation of forearm, which essentially it is, that means loss of carrying angle or decreased carrying angle or reversal. There can be thickening or irregular, that is going to be confirmed by thickening and irregularity of lower end of humerus, especially the supraclavicular ridges. Sometimes it's difficult to identify the lateral epicondyle. The relation of 3-point bony point, however, is maintained, and there will be a downward tilting of the triangle medially at times, actually, and there will be shortening of the arm. Well, this point is not necessarily, you have to mention the downward tilting, because then you're going to be confusing yourself. The shortening of the arm, there can be forearm, again, this point is slightly confusing. I would rather skip this thing, but there can be hyperextension or limitation of flexion. Cubitus varus, this is the clinical picture. And of course, you have to confirm by a radiological examination, AP and lateral. Example of the posterior dislocation of elbow, olecranon is going to be displaced posteriorly. Lower end of the humerus, normal 3-point bony relation will be arterial. The apex is going to go posterior proximal. And there will be boasting sign positive of the tricep is going to become more taut. Arm length equal, but forearm length is going to be decreased compared to opposite side. The radial head in abnormal position, because normally it is because of elbow dislocation, it can be an abnormal position, and there will be limitation of the movement and can be abnormal mobility as well. When you talk of lateral condyle fracture, most common is non-union. Deformity is going to be cubitus valgus, that means increased angle. The lateral supracondylar ridge can be irregular, or there can be a step. And medial supracondylar ridge is going to be normal. There is going to be widening of intra-epicondylar distance, and the distance between the lateral epicondyle and the tip of olecranon is going to be increased. There can be abnormal mobility, especially on lateral condyle. You hold with the bony fragment can actually move in non-union. So this is an example. This is normal. This is ultrasight on the right side and right elbow confirmed by the X-ray. There's a non-union of lateral condyle. Myositis ossificans, history of massage is going to be there and can happen with or without fracture. History of massage, they see treatment, irregular bony mass, mainly in front and can be in behind. Of course, there will be gross limitation on the movements of elbow, and at 10 can be hardly any movement, or maybe ankylosis. Stiffness, what are the causes? Congenital, it can be arthrogryposis, congenita, synostosis, can be post-traumatic or post-infective, or can be because of osteoarthritis. It can be because there can be, what are the common condition which can lead to deformity of elbow? That can flexion deformity or varus valgus deformity. Block can be springy or elastic. There can be firm endpoint, that means soft tissue component, or bony endpoint, that means bony pathology or bony block. It can be impingement present because of presence of loose body or osteophyte in the olecranon fossa on hyperextension and osteophyte in the radial fossa, and there can be pain on the flexion. Any change of arc of motion, you have to compare it with the opposite side. Example of olecranon bursitis on here, it can be because of infection or inflammation of bursa. It can be because of trauma, mainly happen because of chronic pressure, infection, medical condition like rheumatoid arthritis or gout can also lead to olecranon bursitis. Bony impingement of posterior medial tip of the olecranon in the olecranon fossa, and pain occur as the elbow is snapped into extension, more common in throwing athletes. Epicondylitis can be medial or lateral. Medial is golfer's elbow, lateral is tennis elbow. You have to palpate for the medial mass epicondyle while resisting the active pronation. A pain either within the muscle barrier or directly over the epicondyle in golfer elbow. In tennis elbow, palpate the mobile ward while resisting the active supination. And ECRB is the most common offender. Pain within, bicep rupture, palpation in the anticapital fossa, absence of the typical prominent tendon, resisted supination will increase the prominence, and pain in the anticapital fossa, ecchymosis can be present. Lastly, what are the red flags? And you can be asked, red flags can be infections, inflammation, malignancy, fracture, dislocation, inflammatory arthritis, any abnormal vitals along. You don't have to forget the patient as a whole. Abnormal vascular, neurovascular deficit, heterotrophic ossification, inappropriate progression from treatment made after the surgery. So common question you are going to be asked, what is your diagnosis? You have to say that. What next? You have to, don't jump on. If it is history, you have to examine the patient. If examination is done, you have to confirm the diagnosis by X-ray. What is the treatment? Again, it has to be dependent upon the patient's symptom, not the X-ray or just whether you have made a diagnosis. Every diagnosis is not going to yield to same treatment. How to palpate the radial head? Already I've demonstrated how to draw three-point triangle. Already told to you how to palpate ulna and how to demonstrate the carrying angle. How to differentiate various pathology clinically? You have to defend why not this, why this? How to do a neurological examination? You need to know all the nerve examination and how to demonstrate various range of motion. In conclusion, you must develop a systemic approach and follow it. Tick all the boxes, always, every time, anywhere. A thorough history will help you in the guiding and guide you in direct physical examination. You must compare truth always with the non-affected side. Start with the non-affected side and supplement, of course, your examination history with the radiograph study. In the end, please don't forget to thank the patient. Cover him appropriately if you have exposed. Thank you very much. Any questions?